Good evening, bonsoir, guten Abend, Mr. Chairman, dear members, dear friends. It is an honor to be with you here today. First, let me thank you for the continuous support you have given to our country, and thank you also for your recent resolution, which welcomes and reaffirms the enlargement perspective for Kosovo and visa liberalization. Brussels is less than a three-hour flight from Pristina, yet to come here we must travel a great distance over barriers of visa restrictions, misperceptions, and prejudices. I know I'm not the first leader to speak in this honorable institution. Other leaders from Kosovo have spoken before me in different circumstances and different times. I speak before you today as a prime minister of a sovereign, independent country, small but significant, poor but hopeful, new, also ancient, which has at times defended our common European values. As a people, we have suffered occupation from different empires and regimes which sought to assimilate our language and culture, take our land and extinguish our existence, a campaign which culminated with genocide and expulsion of almost 1 million people from Kosovo in 1999. After the Second World War, the world was united to never again let such atrocities and horrors be repeated in Europe, yet they happened in Croatia, Bosnia, and Kosovo. 71 years ago, while Europe was still clearing away the rubble left from the war, at a time when suffering was still immense, hatred and mistrust were prevalent and justice was yet to be done, the idea of cooperation through common institutions was born. The founding fathers of the European Union had experienced the powerful destruction of the war and witnessed the dark side of human reasoning. Where others saw inevitable war, they saw the possibility for peace and cooperation, and when others saw competition in a zero-sum game, they saw an opportunity for all to win. History is a long series of hard lessons, but perhaps the most important part to learn is that peace requires both justice and responsibility. We know that without the Nuremberg trials and Willy Brandt's kneeling, reconciliation would not have happened. The European Union was built through the struggle against fascism, and European peace has anti-fascism at its foundation. So we should never take either the EU or peace for granted, and we must remember that peace is not merely the absence of violent conflict, but the active presence of true justice. A just peace with a welfare state that works for everyone, regardless of nationality, religion, or gender. Which brings me to Kosovo and the much talked about dialogue with Serbia. Kosovo accepts dialogue with Serbia. It wants to resolve all outstanding issues. It wants peaceful relations and cooperation so that our two countries and our two people can work and live in harmony side by side and together. For this reason, 13 years ago, after a process of negotiations in Vienna, led by a UN special envoy, with the consent of world democracies, Kosovo was declared a sovereign and independent country. The independence was a compromise based on a comprehensive agreement which declared Kosovo, a population of 95% Albanians, a multi-ethnic society, created majority municipalities for Serb communities and special protected zones within the territory for religious sites and many other enhanced and special rights, especially for the Serb community. Today, in our parliament, Serbs and other minorities have not only reserved seats, but also a double majority over many laws in the Constitution, rights which cannot even be closely matched with other European countries. These are not opinions to be debated, but facts to be dealt with. Those who have followed me and the movement to which I belong know that as an activist, I have opposed from the very beginning special rights and special zones, and have advocated for independence and self-determination as a right which belongs to us as a people. Now, as a prime minister who has won over 50% of the national vote, my first duty is to protect our sovereignty, our independence, and our constitution. So we are for dialogue, but a dialogue which is well prepared and with principles, just and equal. So let me define now such principles. First is the acceptance of reality. This means that we cannot return to pre-independence. Kosovo's independence, based on Ahtisaari's package, was a compromise. Opening this package means opening a list of desires and drives which would lead to unforeseeable events and unintended consequences. Second is acceptance of the truth. Serbia must accept its past crimes and wrongdoings in Kosovo. To stop genocide, NATO had to bomb Belgrade in Serbia because it was Belgrade, with its regime of Milosevic, who committed genocide in Kosovo. It was a state apparatus with government officials and a chain of command known to everyone. Yet, after the end of the war in Kosovo and after the Milosevic regime, the new government in Serbia has not distanced itself from Milosevic and war crimes. By not distancing itself from the war crimes, Serbia is becoming more closely identified by them. Third is equality of representatives. At any table, we sit as equals to solve existing problems and not to create new ones. Kosovo is not an issue in dialogue, but a party to dialogue, and this must be well understood prior to any new round talks with Serbia. And the fourth principle, citizens must be end beneficiaries. Dialogue cannot be about saving the reputations or careers of politicians in office, but about improving the lives of citizens on the ground. This means that we provide real solutions to real problems, such as the fate of missing persons, of whom one-third are not Albanian, such as providing running water and uninterrupted electricity, building roads and bridges, and bringing communities together around a common purpose. This is the kind of dialogue we want to pursue and which is in line with EU principles of inclusion, coexistence, solidarity, and justice. We must address debts, succession, and war reparations. Approximately 3 billion in pecuniary and non-pecuniary damage of unpaid pensions. Over 400 million in pecuniary and non-pecuniary damage of misuse of electricity network. Kosovo's assets in Serbia and other former republics of Yugoslavia, the status of which has not yet been addressed. War reparations, which must include the guarantees of non-repetition, restitution, and compensation. These are the things we need to talk about and solve, and for which my government is fully committed. Europe has given the world so much, but it has also learned many lessons through war and enlightenment, repression and revolution, and it has only found peace through acceptance of the reality and the truth. That is what we seek, a mirror for us to look at ourselves and recognize ourselves, because history cannot be ignored, because it cannot be repeated. Every spring, Kosovo mourns and remembers the massacres by the Serbian regime in 1998 and 1999 in every corner of the country. As of today, we still have 1,632 missing persons, and 22 years after the war, their families still cannot lay flowers on their graves and grieve in the traditional manner. Their wounds are our wounds. Their suffering is our suffering. That is why the first issue which we should solve is the fate of missing persons. If we cannot make progress in this area, then difficult to make any progress in any other area. So we must not ignore history, because ignoring it would mean ignoring the lessons that are written in the cemeteries of this continent. The European Union is the world's most successful project of peace, prosperity, and well-being. But your progress is a progress which must be shared. Your prosperity must also be shared. I thank this institution for standing up for Kosovo at its most difficult times and for proactively seeking to advance Kosovo on its EU path. But we must do more. Nation states of the EU in the Council must not block the democratic will in the Parliament. Kosovo must be granted visa liberalization and receive a clear path to EU integration with no vetoes and no blockings. We must not seek to replicate the EU in the Balkans through some initiatives which can only delay our membership. But we must increase our regional cooperation so that it makes the membership process easier and faster. The Western Balkans is surrounded by EU countries, and we must be treated as future members, not as neighbors. The faster we move towards the EU, the safer Europe will become from foreign interference seeking destabilization. To conclude, I believe that it is in the interests of both the EU and Europe to come forward with a mini Marshall Plan, a plan which would speed up reforms and complete membership. US Marshall Plan saved and built Europe and created economic miracles. Now it is time for EU to save and build Western Balkans. Thank you.